Good morning again, ladies and gentlemen. If you wouldn't mind taking your seats, please. We're anxious to start our next panel. Our next panel is Designing Environmentally Sustainable Cities, moderated by Edwin Heathcote from the Financial Times. Please join me in welcoming him to the stage.
Wow, that seems a very dispersed panel. I was going to try and keep this conversational, but it's going to be like a conversation across an empty room. Thank you for coming. Good to see you all here. We have a very distinguished panel today, but unfortunately, we don't have Frank Gehry, who had to drop out at the last minute with a bad back, I'm told. So forgive us for that, but we do have, to stand in for him, Francisco Gonzalez-Pulido, Director of Design at JAHN, on the end. Next to him, Ricky Burdett from the London School of Economics, the Cities Programme, Director of the Cities Programme in London. Jeanne Gang, who you'll know, designer of the Aqua Tower and one of the most distinguished architects of the city. And William Reilly of TG Capital, a private investment firm, but with a background in environmental protection and as a government advisor. So I hope you'll agree it's a good panel. I'd like to start with a quote, if I might, from Lewis Mumford, the great critic of cities. He said, "The chief function of the city is to convert power into form, energy into culture, dead matter into the living symbols of art, biological reproduction into social creativity." Well, we're here today to talk about the sustainable city. But when we think about sustainability now, the word has associations of grey water recycling and green roofs, and it's become a little bit banal. If you Google sustainable cities, you get 28,900,000 results. It's become a bit of a kind of urban cliche very quickly. So much so now that I think it's almost being replaced now by resilient cities. So maybe we could look in the same way as Mumford did at something a little broader about the definition of sustainability. To be really sustainable, a city needs beauty as much as it needs money. It needs to be a place of love and good food, of culture and equality of opportunity, all things which are difficult to summarize in a single word. So perhaps in this discussion we'll be able to pick apart some of the threads that allow the city to catalyze this alchemy that Mumford referred to. Mumford also said, "I'm a pessimist about probabilities, but I'm an optimist about possibilities." What can architecture, design, and urbanism, and legislation do to encourage those possibilities? That's what we'd like to talk about today. And I wanted to begin by asking about where we are today, which is Chicago. We have two eminent Chicago architects here. And it seems to me that Chicago is one of the really very few cities in the world that is passionately engaged in its own architecture, that's really interested in its own architecture. And it's something that's valued here in a way I don't think it is elsewhere. And I wanted to turn to Jeanne first, if I might, to ask why the city is so interested in architecture. Obviously, it's the home of the skyscraper and so on. But also what that interest in architecture does for the culture of the city.
Mm-hmm. It's a really interesting question. I think the fact that Chicago was built up, a lot of people refer to Chicago as the most American of cities because by the time people moved this far to the Midwest, it was no longer needed to just replicate styles maybe that were going on in Europe. And maybe that liberated the architects to some extent. I think because Chicago was basically built on a swampland, there was nothing here. It was really a place that was created by people. It was the swamps were drained, the rivers were reversed, and it was a created city, something that required overcoming a lot of hardships and difficult engineering challenges. And so at the same time that the architecture that was being built up, inventing the skyscraper, inventing the frame, the structural frame for the building, suddenly became apparent on the buildings. It is the way that they look. So the city was kind of built up at the same time, in turn of the century, and so it reflects that as well. And it had distinctive style to it.
Yeah.
So I think we are lucky to have a really beautiful crop of Chicago school architecture that kind of formed the basis of the thinking about architecture, which was driven by commerce, really, and also this attitude that it's possible to reinvent and to make anew. There's a lack of nostalgia, which I really appreciate in the city. People are always looking for something new, and so that coupled with the fact that we don't have movie stars and we don't have the international, let's say, media, that there's more of a focus maybe on the environment without these other perhaps distractions of what's new. We don't have the fashion industry as strongly here as you see in New York as well. So unlike LA and New York, the architecture is central.
That's very interesting because you're implying that actually it began as a city that maybe wasn't a global city. It was a city based on beef and grain and the kind of Midwest, the bounty of the Midwest. In a way, almost that its lack of globalness at the beginning is what defined it as a sort of self-sufficient, original place. And the other places that look abroad more and that are more mobile in their populations and so on are actually, they become something different.
And I think architecture here, and Francisco can jump in, but it is based on, there's a strong relationship to engineering and to the idea of doing something that has function. Of course, we are also influenced by Mises' arrival as well in the city and the development of IIT as a place. So those things are embedded in our architecture culture. So we tend to like buildings that also have multiple functions.
Right. Could I turn to you for a moment, Francisco, and ask what is it? What does that passion for architecture and that originality from 120 years ago that still carries on today? What does it do for the culture of the city?
I think it does a lot. I mean, for me, it's a little hard to talk about Chicago as because I'm not really native, you know. I was born in Mexico City. I've been here 15 years. But Jeanne is right. I think what I think is extraordinary about this place is it's been driven by technology has played a central role in the way we have developed this city, you know. And I think the invention of the skyscraper, it was not just a drawing, and a spontaneous drawing, right? It came really from an idea that change a lot of things. And so I think it does a lot for the culture of a place, but I don't think actually this is exclusive of Chicago. Mm-hmm. I have to be frank with you. I mean, our practice is somehow global, and we travel a lot. We're doing buildings in many parts of the world. And I see how architecture really drives people to places, you know. Mm-hmm. I don't think, I see people coming to Chicago, but I see people coming to Ohio as well, because there's great buildings there, right? I mean, there's the Sarinen buildings. And so definitely, I think Chicago is a great example. I have to be frank with you, maybe I get a little controversial. I came really attracted to the past, and when I arrived, I was incredibly disappointed about what I encountered, you know?
Really?
Because I was chasing that dream of the School of Chicago and the 50s and the 60s and the 70s that I think they were incredible in this town, and then suddenly the disastrous 80s and 90s and, you know, we're kind of coming out of it.
Yeah.
It's good that we have Jeanne and other people that really care. But it was really it made an impression on me. And somehow, we, for many years, we were actually not working in the city.
Right.
Because we couldn't find any more resonance to those ideals that really founded this place, you know, for a long time. And I think that's changing. Yeah. Mm. But I still see the excitement of people as they come, how much they engage with the culture of the place through architecture. And what I think is great about Chicago is not only the buildings, really, it's really the spaces. Especially, I mean, the planning of the city is remarkable.
Right.
And their infrastructure, I think the loft buildings on the west side are as interested, if not more, because they have a real function, a real core. You know, they were designed for a reason, and it was not exactly beauty. It was really performance. In general, things that work are beautiful. You know, and I think that was kind of the ideology of this place. So
okay.
I'm hopeful about, you know.
That's interesting. Yeah, it spoils one of my points. I was going to talk about beauty later, but now I don't need to. So now I can go over to you.
sort of as an outsider, and linking your Mumford quote, which is very beautiful, very fresh,
yeah,
and very powerful, is that, I mean, as an outsider, I certainly see the magic of the architecture here and your engagement with it as a profession, very much linked to these two historical moments, which are the promise of modernism in two different phases. One is, the industrial, the city that works, as Saskia would call it, the city that really makes work. You know, it's a no-nonsense grid. It was all about the railways and, you know, architecture which took people up. And then in the 50s, the other canonical moment, Mies van der Rohe, sort of this extraordinary combination of, I guess, functionality, efficiency, and beauty, yeah, going back,
right,
connected with power. And I think it's when that image becomes unclear, whose architecture is it? Not just whose style, who's the client, who's behind it, fits into that. I was also struck by your comment that Chicago didn't start as a global city. I don't know any city that started as a global city.
Well, maybe some of the trading ports.
So the key issue is what role does architecture play in maintaining it? And maybe one of the issues we can come to is that very, very few cities are able to manage that growth,
yeah,
and maintain that. But that's another story. But architecture plays a role in that.
I'd like to ask something. I'm here with architects and urbanists and planners, and I'm an architect, my background. So I'd like to ask something controversial, which is, should we really be building new buildings at all? I mean, if we want to be really sustainable, should we not look at really, really carefully, look at what's already there and see what we can do, whether we retrofit, whether we rebuild the some of the devastated neighborhoods in the South Side or in Detroit or wherever it is, or should we be putting people elsewhere? From a sustainability point of view, do you think we, when I say we, I'm talking about the global north now, not so much about Asia, not so much about the global south, but should we be building at all, do you think?
Well, I'm the non-architect here.
Yeah, that's why I'm asking you.
Yeah. I come from the hinterland. I was brought up early in my life in Decatur. This was the big city. This was the excitement. This was drama. Yeah, this is the first time I ever looked on a body of water that you couldn't see across.
I'm sorry, where were you?
Decatur, Illinois, okay, downstate, yeah, Illinois.
Got it.
And
okay.
It's south of London. It's, you know, can't. And
London, Ontario.
It was always very, very moving to me. I practiced law here for 7 months before I went in the army a long time ago. Expected to return, did not. But when you think about building anew and connecting it to the question of sustainability, sustainability came on the scene, at least in my memory, with the Brundtland Commission, chaired by Gro Harlem Brundtland, the former Prime Minister of Sweden. Right. And the real question that commission was asking was, can we keep this thing going?
Yeah.
Can we continue to place the material demands that we are on nature and expect nature to yield forth enough to give us a civilized life, a culture, the kind of experiences that we have, recognizing that it's a lot. Mm. And you have a World Wildlife Fund annual report that looks at the degree to which we are taking more than the planet produces, and it's something like a planet and a half that we're taking out every year in terms of measures of sustainability, which are very much natural resource, right, measures. But that is where it all started. I think your point was correct, that sustainability has been a little overused.
Yeah.
It now has encompassed any number of things that have to do with the attractiveness of cities, with their, particularly with their ongoing economic potential, whether they can innovate and create enough jobs to keep that going. And that, I don't know whether that's a helpful concept or not, but one of the things one has to say about Chicago is beginning in the mid-1990s, it probably did a better job of calculating its future demands on nature and accommodation, adaptation. I think this issue of whether global cities can really address the climate problem, well, Chicago decided they couldn't really affect mitigation that much, the generation of carbon, mm-hmm. Though they can somewhat with building designs and so forth. But adaptation really belongs primarily to the city, and that is where Chicago has excelled with the climate action plan that they have here with permeable pavements and planting trees that will survive in the new climate and banning spruce, ash, and maple,
yeah.
which I grew up with. I think they'll change the perspective on a lot of things. The ability to demonstrate no carbon buildings, which will only happen in new buildings, is itself worth the candle. I think it's very much worth going on. There are so many things you can do with HVAC systems and insulation and windows and all the rest for existing buildings, and we ought to, because the energy efficiency is the huge resource that we have that we've not exploited.
Sure.
But to really demonstrate the new technologies that I think can both help solve problems in the United States, the carbon problem, and also demonstrate to the Chinas, which are going to build, as we heard, 80% of the housing that will exist in 2030 is yet to be built in China. That is very much worth doing, and the centers of innovation are the ones that will probably pioneer.
Yeah.
I would just add on to what you said about new buildings. I mean, the energy use, the most energy use is coming from the old stock of buildings. And so I think we have to start thinking about the city as something to be perhaps mined for materials, mined for to remake in a better, more efficient way, not just to bulldoze for the sake of growth, but to mine what's there and also start thinking about how the system, that systemically how things are interrelated through the use of resources and how those buildings can connect into that system. So I'm really excited about thinking these days that is treating an urban area more like an ecology and
right.
with waste from one and industry being used for energy for another and getting that going.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. That's very interesting. And I think yesterday I heard twice, I think, the statistic that cities are responsible for 70% of the world's carbon emissions. But they're also responsible, of course, for 70% of the world's economy or more. So it seems it's one of those, the cities seem to be blamed for a lot of things. But actually, it always seemed to me that they're inherently sustainable idea cities. So they should be sustainable because people live together in close proximity. They are communities. They thrive on human relationships and so on.
Well, the positive thing about cities, Eddie, is that you can actually make changes, and the energy footprint and many other things can actually change in a relatively short period of time. And we heard with Carl Bildt the story of Stockholm, Chicago itself, London, city I'm involved in, have in a matter of nearly 15, 20, 30 years, so very quickly, done things which actually have changed that sort of delicate balance. But your provocation that we shouldn't build anything is interesting, and it's probably wrong in the sense that cities are dynamic systems.
Yeah.
You know, and if you take Chicago, take London, they were conceived 150, 200 years ago or longer in the case of London, and they have layering of sort of different levels of infrastructure. One of the biggest problems in terms of the energy footprint of a city is where you have good infrastructure, say good rail or bus systems, but very low density development. So when you use the word retrofitting, I'm completely in favor of that, but then that does require new building.
Yeah.
New buildings of, you know, designed according to the standards and materials that you've talked about. But I don't think, rather than say no building core, I would say, if anything, you shouldn't be building beyond the city as it now stands. You should be thinking of ways of containing growth, densifying, but certainly you need to do new stuff in order to work with the grain to make them more sustainable. Yeah. Would be my sense.
I don't think the problem is really about not building. I tend to agree with you. I mean, I'm very divided because I think just the concept of creating something assumes destruction, right? And it's one of these phrases that I think makes me highly unpopular, but I think it's true. You know, I mean, you in order to make something new, you have to destroy something. You have to take the energy from somewhere, right? So I think the question is not about not building, it's building right. And I think there's not enough legislation. I mean, we deal with that enough, for example, in China. I mean, the developments are, the scale of things are incredible. I mean, we're not building anything like that anywhere else in the world. And when you see what you have to go through, the type of approvals and the difficulty to get these things done, and then the little attention that they really put on what is important, right? Because we did a building in Germany 10 years ago that uses 85% less energy than any building that you built right now. And right. I can really stand for that, you know. And of course, it cost a lot of money. We had a great commitment from the client to do that. But there's a lot of clients. I think the problem is that we're focusing too much on image and profit. And we're not really having a long-term vision of the city. And I think it's not about not building, but there's a lot of crap that gets approved.
Yeah.
Really, yeah. I mean, and that's a shame.
Yeah. You
know? I mean, Chicago is really full of it.
Yeah.
Okay. I'm sorry, you know, but it's true. I mean, every city is, right? Yeah. I'm just using that example because we're here. You know, I'm proud of so many buildings here, but there's a lot of things that get constantly approved, and you wonder, what are these people thinking?
Yeah.
I actually think that, you know, something that coming from Mexico City, being in so many developing countries, and you realize that I think there's a correlation between GDP and sustainability, you know, and between high incomes and sustainability. The richer, they use more.
Yeah.
They spend more. And the poorest, honestly, I mean, they're incredibly sustainable communities. I mean, when you go to the periphery of Mexico City, you wouldn't believe what it takes to sustain life in those places. And they're kind of self-contained, and they work somehow. I don't know. I think,
Francisco, I'm sorry. I don't think you're right when you say that there's a one-to-one correlation between wealth and energy consumption. If you take, and they were referred to both at the discussion last night and in the previous one, the countries of Northern Europe, right? So Denmark, Sweden, etc., where income, GDP, population growth, the economy has grown pretty dramatically, not as much as China or elsewhere, but for a European and global North context has grown really quite a lot, so 2, 3%, 5% a year. What has actually happened there, it's what is known as the decoupling, that as the economy has grown, the energy footprint per person has actually dropped. So those are actually incredibly interesting and positive models, where even, you know, those countries in the world which are moving towards economic growth and improvement and reduction of poverty need to see ways of actually doing positive things. So I would be a little bit more positive than you are, even though I completely agree that it is in particularly Latin American countries where you see incredible innovation in sort of in models of local sustainability. But I wouldn't just point the gun at anyone who's sort of going up the ladder, because otherwise, what model are we going to follow?
Yeah.
I would say something about China that, as we have heard, is planning to accommodate something like the population of the United States or its equivalent. Right. In cities in the next 15 to 20 years. They have been doing it in a very unattractive way. I mean, they think Chicago's full of it. Beijing is a model for how you ought not plan residential development, especially. And the Energy Foundation that I've worked with in China for some years went to the mayor of Kunming when he was planning a major expansion. And he was planning it in the traditional way with these very large block buildings, so large that even walking from in the interior to the gate is a stressful thing. It would be very unfriendly to pedestrians, to bicyclists, to the streetscape, and to public transportation, and no green space. And the Energy Foundation went to him and said, this is a big mistake. you're going to find that you will have more pollution, you will use more energy, you will have less comfortable, healthy, satisfied people. And he said, well, what do you propose? I'll give you 30 days. And I think about this business of building and innovating. Well, the ideas that were then brought to him were innovated here and in the Western world. And they were essentially Jane Jacobs' concepts or Holly White's concepts or Jan Gehry, I remember, who told me this, his wife said once when he was brought up in the Le Corbusier tradition to accommodate the car and build the high buildings and large open spaces. She said, funny that you, she's a psychologist, funny that you count cars but you don't count people.
Right.
And he said it was a transformational moment for him. And he was the great planner of Copenhagen.
Yeah.
Well, bus rapid transit was part of the new plan. Smaller blocks were included. A lot of green space. Very accommodating approach for bicyclists and pedestrians. And the big question, and the question for, I think, architects, and particularly architects with great names, is will it catch on? Will it have a cachet that will cause Chinese people to want to live in that way, in those apartments? Well, the answer, the early answer is yes. The buildings, apartments are selling very well. That's a new phenomenon. The mayor happens to be vice chair of the party. He's well situated to have influence, and perhaps that can grow. If it doesn't, I think the consequences for climate, for carbon dioxide emissions, for all of the rest, continued congestion due to the fact that it was really, the original plan was all built around cars, and only a small percentage of Chinese actually have cars now, and already it's unsustainable. But that's a good reason why the kinds of transformations that have taken place in Western cities, which have become much more friendly to pedestrians. I was in the army in Frankfurt, and it was a really dour, depressing place. I mean, I was so impressed that Germans can make solar work, because I never saw the sun when I lived there, but they have. But we went back there in the 80s, and it was as though it was a different city, and I remember thinking, well, where's this second-rate architecture? Well, it was still there, but you didn't notice it because of the streetscape, because of the paving, because of the flags and the outdoor cafes and all of the cultural amenities, pedestrian zones that had been designed into it. That was a much more sensitive basis for pleasure, for creativity, for interaction in cities, and probably contributed significantly to its sustainability, certainly to the desire of people to live there.
Sure.
Though innovation had a lot to do with that, and the fact that it has been demonstrated in Western cities that approach really does work.
Yeah.
That's a very important reason to keep that going, I think.
Okay. Jeanne, did you want to jump in there?
Well, I was just thinking about what you were saying, that and the role of let's say design, the role of design to make things get traction or to be adopted. And I think that's really it's very interesting, because even though right now many of us are really interested in these bigger picture elements about how cities work and how you can retrofit and deal with stormwater and all these things that are so crucial in retrofitting the post-industrial city. But it's impossible to get funding for gigantic projects that will transform our cities. So this is when I think architecture starts to come into a very strong role. I was thinking of a project we did here locally called the Nature Boardwalk at Lincoln Park Zoo. Mm-hmm. It was essentially just a decorative pond built to stroll around in Lincoln Park. And we re-envisioned this pond to be a stormwater management system, but took out the edges and made it deeper so fish could winter over, and surround it with plants that clean the runoff water that goes into the pond. And that is the most significant thing about that place. But it wouldn't have worked unless we had architecture. And we designed a very small pavilion, just an open-air pavilion there with a boardwalk. And it's the combination of re-engineering major systems, but also design, I think, that has the power to both be funded, funded by cities and individuals, and also to make it happen. And so it's, even though maybe the design part is not crucial, let's say, for for making this system work, it is crucial for making it a place that people want to be. Yep. Yeah.
I would guess the stormwater regulations had some impact on it too, no? It was cheaper to do it that way than to do a structural accommodation of the stormwater?
It definitely could be. I mean, this was a kind of, the whole project was a reinvention of this very shallow pond. So it was not an inexpensive project, but now it is, yeah, it would, mm-hmm. instead of building gray pipe under cities, to start thinking of how to make space to manage some of this, the stormwater in an open environment, and also making a very attractive place for people and animals.
There's been a lot of concern with getting adequate capital to adapt cities for climate. Mm-hmm. And one of the important points that you imply is that there are non-structural ways, or at least relatively non-interventionist ways, to redesign landscapes. And they've done this more, I think, effectively in Philadelphia than any place I can think of, green infrastructure, which essentially says plan the swales to retain the water, be prepared to seed the space when you get a high water mark or a flooding or heavy rains, yeah. and then it will back off again. The mayor of New York did some of this. His chief planner, Alex Washburn, said the mayor looked at, Bloomberg, looked at the city of New York, and he saw six boroughs. The five boroughs we know about, plus the waterfront. And you go to see the Brooklyn waterfront today, and it's transformed. Mm-hmm. And that's true of many of these other places. But in quite a number of places, they're going to have to figure this out in Miami Beach, which has got a much bigger problem with sea level rise than anywhere else. And so far, they're putting in pumps. But I'm told by scientists that because of the substrate, the limestone, you won't be able to keep it out. It will come in. Well. The landscape interventions that can seed that space, retain the water, and then let it gradually work its way out, or, more important in many places, possibly here when the rain patterns change as they're expected to, go into the groundwater and maintain that kind of resource.
I think architects are going to become less and less relevant, and landscape architects are going to become more and more relevant as we move into this systemic thinking about the city, and I'd be interested in what anyone else thinks about that.
That's interesting. I'll just butt in with something myself here, which is I was in New York last week, and I was staying at a hotel near the High Line, so I wandered down the High Line, and you couldn't walk. And it's a very interesting, it's reuse, it's landscape, it's all of these things.
Yeah. But rails to trails.
The cumulative effect of this wonderful scheme has been a massive gentrification of that part of the city. And that's something else I think we hear a lot about. It's a popular topic at the moment, sustainability, but also how you create an equitable city. And I wonder actually what architects and planners can do to somehow maintain a social mix, whether actually they can do anything, whether it's out of their hands. If an architect creates something brilliant in a down-at-heel neighborhood and it gentrifies it, is that the architect's fault? Is there any way architects and urbanists can build in a kind of prevention strategy?
This is where, and I think, you know, the practicing architects here are recognizing it anyway. In a way, there's an enormous limit on what a building, however beautifully designed, however sustainable, can do without addressing the bigger problems of the urban or metropolitan scale, because often the two are actually quite different. Just to answer your point, what can be done to, let's say, redistribute or design a city more equitably? First of all, I think the environmental argument and the social argument are actually coming together. And this is one of the strongest changes in the last 20, 30 years. We still separate them out, even in this conference. You know, we have discussions on social issues and discussions on environmental issues. But actually, let's call it, broadly speaking, the more compact, better connected city does two good things. It is kinder on the environment, and it's better in terms of mixing people of difference. And those two things are at the heart of the notion of, I think, the sustainable city in both ways. Just, Eddie, if we can use our city of London as one example, just a very simple case, which over the last 15, 20 years has been a big recognition, and an architectural project has tried to address it, the London Olympics, is that broadly speaking, London is divided into a better off, less disadvantaged West and a poorer, less educated East. I'm exaggerating enormously. Yeah. Right? Obviously, that resonates north-south, perhaps, in this city, and different cities have different sort of DNAs of inequality. the whole project of the London Olympics was to, as the politicians called it, create convergence. At the moment, if you're born in West London, you can live as a man to 78. If you're born in East London today, you live 7 years less in life expectancy. So the political language that was used was, could we rebalance effectively life choices? Could we create convergence? And that is about providing the infrastructure of transport, of education, of parks, of housing, in areas that actually on the whole were sort of under-provided. Of course, what that does is also provide much greater intensification, your notion of retrofitting, but at the macro scale, you need to start from that view, which is then also a political view of where the city is going to go, and that raises questions of who makes that decision, and at what scale is that made in terms of region and everything else. But I think I'm being incredibly positive, and very interesting to hear major US politicians and the extraordinary people who were here before talking about the importance of urban planning, which is sort of needing to come back as not just a technical thing where you measure things, but you actually have a sort of political vision which deals with the environmental and the social together.
These are important considerations, and they're getting more attention than they have. But I can't say that based on the experience, for example, of San Francisco, where I live, is encouraging in with respect to the gentrification of the area. We have an area that's the Mission, which is historically a Hispanic area. The transportation is not a problem there particularly, but the innovative techies and a lot of people who are working in Silicon Valley have just been swarming in, so that the first instance of conflict had to do with their taking apartments, and then the second was the buses that transport them every morning to and from their jobs. It's not clear to me how you deal with that issue. The mayor doesn't, on the one hand, wants to accommodate the people who are being displaced. On the other hand, doesn't want to get in the way of obvious investment that is taking place. So the first thing that you get is an argument: if there's to be new building, well, how much of it is going to be for the disadvantaged?
Yeah.
And typically, environmentalists tend to want to reduce the density. And that has a consequence of reducing also the accommodation of
Do they want to reduce the density?
Why do they want to reduce the density? To increase open space? I think it's a classic kind of reflex of environmentalists to assume that less building will be better for the environment. So against high rises and things of that sort. And that's been a phenomenon for a long time. I remember William H. White wrote a book, The Last Landscape.
The opposite is true.
It's a big mistake to do that, because you are eventually going to result in taking more land and resources. But that's San Francisco's dilemma right now. Do they stand in the way of it? How aggressively do they do it? What is it enough to say, well, some proportion of the new buildings must be allocated to the less well-off?
San Francisco, it's interesting because the city is much more aware of trying to maintain affordability within the city core. They might be failing at doing that, but there is more legislation and more rules that make it possible to have a project that we're working on right now there has 30% affordable housing within this brand new building. Cities do that differently, but it seems that there needs to be a bigger shift to in the economy to allow people to live together instead of north, south, and east, west. How could we make cities so that people can live in the same space with different incomes?
But the new residents are perfectly happy to live there. They like it. They like the mix. I don't think that's so much the concern.
Francisco,
it's just they're spending more money.
I wanted to go back to all over the world.
I wanted to go back a little bit to your point, because I think I agree with Jeanne. I think I don't know if the architect's role is going to change so much. I think we need to change the way we work. we've been working in a very collaborative way for the last 15 years in our practice, and it's not a practice that is centered on the great mind that designs what building and changes the world. It's really, we're trying to see how behavior, economics, sustainable issues, as they relate to the traditional way of thinking of sustainability, affect what we do. But something that just to give you an example that we're doing right now in Mexico City, I actually designed a baseball stadium for the main team in Mexico City, and it's in a very tough area. It's actually an area that there's extreme poverty, crime around it. It's very violent. It's a difficult place, yeah? And you're talking about a city that is 24 million people, right? And this is one of the biggest neighborhoods. The person that is behind the project has donated a bunch of money to do this. The city has donated the land. And what I think is very important that architects understand, and that's really my point, is that it's not anymore about the building. We're too focused on this, and this is what I meant when I said the image of things, you know? I mean, image and profit are killing us. Mm-hmm. We gotta start thinking about what is really important. When we start looking at the building, we said, okay, this building has to be contextual, has to be Mexican somehow, has to relate to its function. But you know what was more important, and it is more important today? What is around the building? And how the building is connecting the community, the program that we're creating around the building. So this becomes the temple, the market, the church. That's why I'm calling it a baseball park and not a stadium. Because I said this building is not going to, it's going to destroy the paradigm of the American stadium that is a fortress. It has to be porous, it has to be for everybody. The owner has made a commitment that 3,000 seats are going to be free. So I think architects working in a much more collaborative way with other disciplines, not only our traditional disciplines like engineers, mechanical engineers, mm-hmm. scientists, but sociologists, historians. Understanding really behavior is so important to what we do. Mobility. I mean, the place where this stadium is, mobility is an absolute critical point to the success of the project. How we're gonna, there's huge boundaries around those, highways, it's completely disconnected, yeah? Mm-hmm. So, and we're actually facing, the city has this great thing, and we're facing great resistance, you know, to get approvals on things. On something that is going to be a detonator of urban activity. We know it. Mm-hmm. Because the political agenda is more important. Mm-hmm. And I think this is another big problem which we face in many places too. China, one of them, you know. So I think...
But how do you reconcile? I mean, this is, you have an extraordinary client. This guy.
Well, so far, right? So far.
I mean, he's pretty exceptional.
Things check out, right?
I mean, the question is, before you were making the interesting comment that, you know, how many planning authorities who gives permission to the horrible buildings in your city? Maybe you haven't been to London recently, but we're competing seriously in terms of the horror landscapes, in terms of the
My comment was not about Chicago, it was really about...
No, but that's a general point.
A lot of cities have...
But how do you reconcile the fact that a lot of regulation in Mexico City and elsewhere actually goes against the sort of type of porous, collective, engaged, adaptive city that you're talking about? Because regulation tends to kill many of the things that maybe all of us in this room think are desirable. Developer will tend to spend less money rather than more. That's why you've got an amazing guy. But
To be honest, I think it has to do a lot with education. Yeah. I mean, the role that we see these days playing as architects is educators. I mean, a lot of, just to give you an example that to me is kind of extraordinary. We built a building in China 8 years ago that uses 30% less material than if we would build it today. Because these people are run by fear. They have had some accidents that are based on the quality of construction. They have nothing to do with design, really. And they're actually constraining now the profession to act in a certain way to get a certain result. And it's actually, when I think of sustainability in a very technical, in a little pocket, I think weight is actually a critical parameter to make things sustainable. And now we talk about a building that, you know, in the press, it appears as, oh, it uses 30% less energy. Oh, yeah, but it weighs 30% more, right?
Yeah.
Because the codes are pushing us to do this. So a lot of our role is to educate these people, to really talk to them and say, this is the right thing to do. This building that I was telling you in Germany that we built, the client was spending whatever money on it. They were believing in building a great machine, something that uses, a building that uses no energy, if possible, right? But you know what was difficult? To convince them to monitor the building. Mm-hmm. We were telling them, look, what you're doing is meaningless if we cannot get data to prove that what we're doing makes any sense. And because technology has makes us much more visible, they were afraid of these things being published, you know, being the company that is using more energy than they thought they would. And at the end, the result is that they accepted. We monitored the building for 10 years. And the monitor actually uses less energy than we thought it would.
Yeah.
So now they look good. But they were so afraid of that. So that process of educating your client, it's so difficult. I don't have the answer, of course. I mean, but you have to do it. And it's, like I said, it's not anymore about the building. And I think this is what architects are overlooking. You know, we go there with objects to keep consolidating our image. And this is, I think we have a great social responsibility and we're not acting this way.
Mm-hmm. Frank Gehry made an interesting point. We had a conversation on the phone in preparation for his non-appearance. And he mentioned that actually the raft of regulation, and not just regulation, but the lead targets and so on, the sustainability and environmental targets that are applied to architecture are actually, in a lot of ways, hindering development. Because what happens is you introduce a framework, and the developer meets the targets within that framework and has no incentive to go any further. So actually, the end result is a box that meets the environmental standards, and everyone's delighted, and the developer gets awards for sustainability. Mm. But actually, what we have is a dumb box, which is completely boring technology, and it's not a beautiful thing, and it's not something that pushes anything forward. So there's no experimentation in it.
Well, I think that I agree with Francisco that measurement is everything, and every other field measures performance, especially in design. If you see, the auto industry, it's all about measuring performance. And we are so far behind in architecture and measuring performance. And so at least LEED is one way that has been adopted that there's plenty to critique about it, but it is helping buildings as a whole come up. And now there's other standards of measurements that are even, more strict. And then as those become regulated, like cities start to say, you can only do a LEED, whatever, gold, then I think it brings the whole group up. There's always going to be people that want to break and do better. And, of course, those are the people that we like to work with. But I still think that it is crucial to measure performance.
A major developer in California made a remark to me. He said the single most influential regulation in California is not even a regulation, it's LEED. You cannot get financing for a major development unless it's LEED. And it struck me that, well, that's the culture that's decided that, really.
Mm-hmm.
And then if you look at the performance that was advertised in the construction of a building that's designed to be energy efficient, very often the performance doesn't come close to what in fact was promised. I don't know how that happens, or why, whether our metrics are wrong, or whether our monitoring in the beginning, or we insufficiently understand the HVAC systems and the rest, but it does strike me that's an important, I started the Energy Star program when I was EPA administrator, and we had a lot of confidence in these various approaches in their reducing energy use and therefore pollution. But it doesn't seem to be justified.
Well, it's great that we're having this conversation about it. I mean, it's a totally different conversation than 10 years ago when we didn't hold things up to this measurement to say, oh, you got financing, you're LEED this, and we didn't have that conversation about how is it actually performing. So I think it's really important to have the measurement. I think it also could be applied to measuring cities' performance. Mm-hmm. Now that we can take data points from so many things with technology, and we have people contributing to data on their cell phones, and we can see how people are using bikes. And there's so many data points for cities, and so I think it's a really exciting frontier to think about comparing cities and how much energy they use.
Ricky, you forgive me, Frank. Sorry, you want to?
Yeah. Go ahead.
I just wanted to ask Ricky because you've been studying some very interesting schemes across the global South, actually, and particularly in Latin America, haven't you? Where they've used data, but they've used very intelligent approaches to public transportation, to intervening in the informal communities.
Yeah,
I think we could often learn lessons in the north.
I think Francisco was already
alluding to that before when you were saying that, say, in Latin America, there are extraordinary examples of effectively retrofitting the system. This is where I think we're probably on the same page, and it's in perhaps a new mantra. But the examples are introducing cable cars in cities with very steep inclines where people don't have access to jobs or can't get to school in time. By retrofitting that particular environment with a cable car, you actually literally change the economy and the sort of the potential of the individuals there. Going back to Mumford, the role of art and education, again in the city of Medellin, the presence of a library next to one of these cable car stops means that actually it becomes a meeting place where education is actually privileged and given sort of significance. Now, I think, if anything, the advances in many of the countries that perhaps you work in and we've been studying at the LSE are not being followed by the slightly tired, slightly lazy global north countries. I can't think of a project as exciting as the ones that I've talked studied in Colombia, Rio, for that matter, and elsewhere in my city.
No.
I mean, I think there's a sort of getting used to the state feeds everything and you don't need to be that down. And it's the invention of architecture which is adaptable, which actually doesn't respond to the program that you're giving, as you're doing with the stadium, but actually responds to programs that one doesn't know, which would help, I think, the critical issue in sustainable cities, which is to reduce the need to travel.
Right.
Because if you start, think of the medieval city, the Italian city, where everything is clustered together, so to speak. Not advocating that that's the model for Chicago or anywhere else. But if you take that model of the compact city, which ends somewhere, and that actually it's a walk from where you live to where you work, etc. Now, the scale obviously is different, but you can reproduce that even in a footprint of a city like London, 8.5 million people, Chicago, by having multi-centered places where around transport you need to move less to go to work, to go shopping, to be educated, and to sleep. And I think that's just something we're not picking up because of interest in land and speculation. I think that's an area we haven't talked about.
I think there's actually an element of re-education in terms of perceived comfort as well, that I think is actually a very important issue, Eddie. You know, like, it strikes me, you know, we design a building in Switzerland that 4 months of the year, the building is not using any heating or cooling, right? Because these people have understood that it's actually possible to live without it, right? And we designed the building in a way that it has an atrium, it has an operable roof that literally opens, right? Opens the building in the season, so you're feeling that you're outdoors. And I think it impresses me, for example, when I came to the States, that Chicago was, and I know the weather is very extreme, but in my building we go from cooking, right?
Yeah.
To the beach, right, basically. Yeah. I mean, so we're like cooking and then we're, you know, and then we're kind of freezing, right? And I'm like, isn't there a time where actually we couldn't be using this thing? Can we just train people to be more tolerant about comfort? I mean, the impact that could have in our energy consumption could be huge. You know, when we think about conditioning of spaces, large volumes, right? Look at this building, you know, probably the air is coming from there. The more unsustainable thing in the world, right? The air should be coming from here.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Who cares if the temperature there is 25 degrees? You want 25 degrees here, right?
But it's probably 25 degrees out.
We're not thinking that way.
Yeah, exactly.
You know, we're not thinking that way. So it's a technical issue. I mean, it's a complex thing, but I think actually comfort needs to be, I always think that I would love that my kid gets a class in comfort. You know, what it means, really. What it means to in terms of your energy consumption, the impact that you're having in others, right?
Yeah.
And I think education, I think, is a very important aspect because a lot of these leaders that are making decisions, they have no clue.
Yeah. You mentioned Medellin and the library parks, Ricky, but they're particularly fascinating to me because they were the result of a kind of local plebiscite, weren't they? People were asked what they wanted. So people living in the informal settlements were asked what it was that would improve their lives. Do they want a park? Do they want a school? They could have any civic building, and they voted for a library, which seems to me the most extraordinary thing, that that the poorest of the poor would be that visionary that they ask for a library. And obviously, it's a very
Eddie, that's
multi-
a bit of a dangerous phrase to use, frankly.
But
when the biggest problem in that city is literacy, of course, that's what you aspire to.
Sure, but...
And having a space where with books or a computer, it doesn't seem to me such a stretch for someone to
recognize. Not at all, but
recognize.
What it indicates, I think, is that people have a very sophisticated vision of what they want their city to be.
Yeah. Well,
but the leaders don't. And whether it's because of the political cycles or a lack of vision or as Francisco says, lack of education, my impression, and I'd like to ask your opinions of it, is that London, for example, has no idea really what it wants to be. It's so pleased with itself at the moment for being a global city and for being so wealthy and attracting more billionaires than New York that it really has no idea what that means,
A lot of the squares are empty at night.
That's exactly what it means.
No lights in the buildings.
That's exactly right.
Neighborhoods and the local joints are suffering and there's less of a culture on the street. But we looked at that and apparently those are the same kind of people who have a huge amount of money and live there part-time and do put money into the culture and the economy. So nobody wants to stop it.
Yeah. What are the cities, we'll wrap up shortly and go out to some questions from the audience, but what are the cities, can I ask you in turn, forgive me, I don't like to go bang, 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 but I guess that's the only way we do this, that are getting it right. So what are the cities, there could be one or two examples that you've seen recently that you think are approaching the architecture, the planning, the environmental sustainability, and really doing something special, even if they're not quite at the optimal level yet, that they're doing interesting things.
I think American cities have done very well by their waterfronts.
Right.
In the past 30, 40 years, they used to be open cesspools, a lot of them. There was one that caught fire famously for several days. That's true in Boston, New York, San Francisco, and so many other cities, that Cleveland. There are pieces, uh-huh, I think, that have done very well.
Right.
There are public spaces that do very well. I think of Amsterdam and Copenhagen as two European cities that one is very comfortable in. I really like to be there. There's a kind of, I don't know, there's joy in the streets, but there's certainly a lot of pedestrian activity and a lot of bicycle activity. And that's also taken off in many of our cities as well, which I think is a big advantage. The pedestrian zones, what Bloomberg did in New York with Times Square, it's fabulous. It's a source of gaiety and excitement, and the tourists and the locals all like it and congregate and linger there, and in the surrounding areas. So there are many successes, I think, in the cities. I don't think you can look at cities which are large, complex animals and expect that in every respect and in many neighborhoods you will see the same kind of thing. But I think there are things to be proud of and things to emulate.
Jeanne, can I ask you the same question?
I think I go to the Nordic countries in terms of energy production. A lot of places like Copenhagen are using burning waste and very efficiently and cleanly and making energy from that. So that's a big investment, and it takes leadership and support to make that kind of shift to that kind of energy. And I think all American cities could learn from that. And I don't know what the prohibition is about that technology, but we have not been able to adopt it here. And then I think of cities that geographically do something interesting, like maybe Portland, where you mentioned, Ricky, the green belt, kind of a no-build zone that creates more density with the inner core, mm-hmm, but also provides a place for local foods to be produced, mm-hmm, close to the center where people need the food. So I think that's a very smart strategy as well.
Okay. Ricky?
Well, you know, the problem with being third is that all the good ones have gone already.
No,
I think the amazing thing about Portland, that in the United States, to actually go against the trend and think of an urban growth boundary, that's amazing. You know, and when is that going to happen here? You know, that's the sort of challenge. I would say, apart from some of the Nordic cities, we've talked about the obvious things, but boring things like district heating systems below ground, 98% of sort of the energy and the heat is redistributed through heat and power systems. That's an enormous achievement and requires, you know, and there are several cities which have done that. I would say that I applaud the mayors of London, two of them in sequence, who, despite being terribly self-satisfied, we are in London, that's absolutely true, but at the moment, $1.5 billion is being spent in a network of cycleways across the whole city. We've doubled cycle use in 10 years, from 1% to 2%. We've got a hell of a long way to go, right? But you know, that's sort of another thing that is happening in that city is an investment of $26 billion in a high-speed underground rail line that will liberate, effectively, land for housing and many other things in the poorer east side of London called Crossrail. I think those are also things which could only have happened with a directly elected mayor.
Right.
And this is just a connection to many of the things we've been saying. You need to be as innovative with thinking of new institutions as you are with thinking of new buildings. I'm not against buildings and designs, but we never had a directly elected mayor in London. We invented one in 2000. So some of the things that that I've talked about flow from that decision. So I would single out at least those two examples. But then, you know, I think what Rio is trying to do in a situation of great difficulty, what Mexico City has begun to do with its bringing back to life the beautiful Centro Histórico, are extraordinary models of where cities are going to go. And there's no one perfect model, but there are different elements in others. There are some cities which are basket cases.
Yeah.
And I won't mention.
Okay. In case you have to lecture there. Understood.
You know, there's an interesting organization, Eddie, that is called Arcadis, and they publish an index. They call it the Index on Sustainable Cities. Okay. Mm-hmm. They're actually Dutch, and kind of interesting because the 10 most sustainable cities in their list are European, which I believe is true. Yeah, I mean, I think Jeanne is right. I mean, I think America still has a lot to learn on how to deal with energy, especially. I think this is a critical thing. I was surprised to see in that list Frankfurt as one of them. It never really crossed my radar as a city that is so sustainable. So actually, I went there. I've been there, and it's true. I mean, sustainability is such a complex topic because it involves so many things. You know, architects, we reduce it to energy consumption or having some stupid green plan somewhere, whatever, right? But it's really not about this, right? We know that. And I think Frankfurt, in that sense, has done a remarkable job. Pedestrian connectivity is incredible. The city has a certain compactness.
Yeah.
I think you were making the right point. I think there was a little bit of a confusion on density. I think concentrated density is green. Mm-hmm. Sprawl is not, right? Mm-hmm. So I think this is the difference. And I think Frankfurt, in that sense, they've done a remarkable job. Clean air, investment on green technologies. So I think I would say Amsterdam, definitely great. And I think from Latin America, yesterday, the CEO of MasterCard mentioned Colombia, which I think, going back to your point, transportation, absolutely key to solve the problem. You know, sometimes I think, what would be the Chicago loop without any cars? You know, if everything would be pedestrian and we had an underground system. I mean, just think about not cleaning that snow. I mean, this is an incredible amount of energy that we spend on just doing that. If cars wouldn't exist, this would be parks, right?
Yeah.
I'd say a quick word about Portland.
Absolutely.
There's an institutional reason why it has developed as it has. As a group back 25, 30 years ago, 1,000 Friends of Oregon began a campaign to try to protect green space and farmland throughout Oregon. This was an environmentalist group, but they were very sensitive to also promote density and development, and actually to contest down zonings and things of that sort in the city of Portland. So the developers, a good many of the, I think the more far-sighted ones, decided, well, this is actually good for us. They got support where they hadn't expected to get it. It had consequences. They were able to increase the density in the cities, and the trade-off was protection of the green space and the farmers markets and all the rest that came from that. That is a marvelous, I think, example of how you can achieve these things sometime, promote them institutionally with laws.
Right.
Eddie, can I just, a small word of warning of rankings and all that, because if you look at the rankings of the best, most competitive, most sustainable cities, inevitably they come out as the most boring cities in the world.
Absolutely.
Lausanne, Geneva, no, Copenhagen is fine. But I mean, so I think the need for messiness is actually part of the story here. We can't have just a perfect, sanitized Swiss environment.
I think that's absolutely right. I'm so sorry. I have a picture of a kind of a psycho being killed, but
I'll get together at the clubs tonight.
So I have to. I have to not ask. Not. Put questions out to the floor. Forgive me. I'm so sorry. Maybe we can mingle over lunch or something, and you can ask your questions if you have any.
Are you talkative?
Yeah, here. That's right. Too good a panel. Too good a panel. What a lovely problem to have. Thank you so much to the panel. Thank you so much for your attention. Thanks for the Chicago Forum, and I hope the rest of the day is good. Thank you.
Thank you. Several bits of housekeeping before we head out for lunch. We will not be coming back here, so if you have anything in the hospitality suite on the chargers or any bags, please take them with you. Also, obviously, the artwork is very distracting, but if you could head straight to lunch so that we can make sure that we make our buses this afternoon for the panels. Now, I will see you later this afternoon. Thank you. Enjoy your lunch.